Hello everybody and welcome to episode number 8 of my weekly review. And what a week it was. We had RuneFest, we've had the Spellbook Rework, as well as a ton of new community updates. Again, in this series, we're not going to be focusing on drama, just on information. I hope you guys enjoy and let's get started. Before I get started here, I just wanted to mention that I'm not going to be talking about RuneFest at all. I have an update video on all three of the major pieces of content coming next year, and I will leave a link in the description for those. So we got one content update this week. On October 11th, we got the Spellbook Rework Wise Old Man update and an increased zoom function for the vanilla client. So the Spellbook Rework is something that we've been waiting for quite a while. I went ahead and tested it out on my phone, and it's quite nice. So we can sort via combat spells, you can sort via teleport spells, you can sort by spells that you have the level to cast, and you can sort by spells that you have the runes to cast. As you narrow down your filters more and more, it will make the spell icons larger and larger. Mod West went ahead and redid all the spell icons, so now they can stretch to a larger dimension and still look good. We've also taken the opportunity to tidy up a couple of the long-standing niggles. I don't know if that's a word in Canada, but anyway, they went ahead and fixed something, if anyone has any idea what that means. So this is an awesome change. I'm so happy it came out before mobile, of course. So another small change is they've changed the size of the special attack bar. I'm not really sure if I like the look of it now, although it is good that it is bigger. I kind of wish it was just all green and the same amount of gray on the outside, but maybe that's just me. The deposit boxes have received the same functionality that the banks do. You now have a quantity option for depositing. You can do 1, 5, 10, X, or all. And if you haven't noticed, when you are switching between achievement diaries, quests, minigames, and whatnot on your phone now, there'll be a little arrow where before you had to click on the tiny little icon, so it's a little bit easier to cycle between them. And next up here, probably one of the best quality of life updates we've received in the entire game, and that is the functionality of the Wise Old Man is now extended for members' items. So now you can open up the Wise Old Man's Recycling Center interface, and it's going to show you a list of all of the useless quest items that you still have in your bank, and you can remove them all at once if that's what you want. However, I have heard of there being some quest items in there that still actually have a use, so it would probably be in your best interest to still go ahead and look at all of them. They also posted a small dev blog on how they managed to do it, so for those who are interested, it's actually a pretty nice read. And last up here, we received an increased zoom distance update for the vanilla client. For those using runelite, it probably won't make any difference. One positive thing that could be received on other clients because of this is they may increase the render distance for objects and whatnot. A while ago, they reduced the render distance for objects in the game because third-party clients like OS Buddy were having an advantage because they were displaying, because with their OpenGL mode, you're able to see further and see objects further than the regular client. So maybe now that they've increased the zoom distance, they might switch that back, in which case you'd be able to see things further away that weren't just terrain items. And that is it for content updates this week. So now for community updates, let's start off with a small update to the Kebos Lowlands poll blog. So for a full review of the Kebos Lowlands, there will be a link in the description for this, but there's a few changes that they've made based on our feedback. First up, they've moved the herb patch from the first tier of the farming guild now to the second. They have lowered the farming level requirement for snake grass from 71 to 61. They confirmed that the Dragon Under Lance is a one-handed weapon, and they've added an additional question for the ferocious gloves to require the completion of Dragon's Lair 2. And they've also changed the rate of receiving mulch pearls from 1 in 150 to 1 in 100. They've changed potato cactuses and snape grass seeds to state that they come from pickpocketing master farmers rather than nests. They've changed the requirements for ferocious gloves from 80 defense to 80 attack and defense. So I am glad they've changed the requirements for ferocious gloves. However, I still wish they were tied to the Barrow's gloves, because now you can still skip out on doing Recipe for Disaster if you wanted to, although Dragon's Lair 2 is still a high level requirement. Next up here, Runelite actually received an awesome update this week. There are now bank tags. So now you can tag individual items and have them display in its own separate tab, and it kind of slides around the left side of it. It's extremely useful. I would recommend giving it a try. It gives way more versatility to your bank, and you can set individual setups just on that tag. So a lot of people were wondering how much gold was removed from the dual arena tags. And Mod Lotti actually posted an interesting stat a few days ago. Apparently 21 billion gold coins are removed from the game every day thanks to the new dual arena tax. That is a seriously substantial amount of gold. So I think the dual arena tax has been a success overall. And lastly up here, I just wanted to mention one thing. Party hats. If you have them, you should sell them. There seems to be a misconception that party hats might be made discontinued like they were in RS3. I think this was caused by misreading one of the polls from a few months ago regarding rare items. So party hats this year have gone up way higher than they have in the past, so I'd recommend selling them pretty much now, because they are confirmed to be planning on dropping them in November or December whenever they do that, and then they're going to be worthless again. And that is it for community updates this week. Okay, so like every week, I like to do a quick recap of the weekly Q&A. So this week, a lot of the questions are regarding, well, warding especially, but lots of the RuneFest items, so just keep that in mind. So first up here, what are your thoughts on hiding poll results as an issue of integrity? They said they pulled it in the past and it failed. However, some of the moderators feel like it should be hidden. They said that it could easily be sidestepped by third-party clients. In the end, most people will be able to sidestep it somehow, but they would like to revisit the idea. Smithing and crafting use free-to-play items, however, warding uses farming and hunter, which is pay-to-play. How will this work with the free-to-play side of this skill if it's released? Said in F2P, there will be flax-type fields and monsters that will give the resources, so there will be ways for them to obtain them. Would you consider moving enchanting spells to warding if it's added? They said no, it's not something we're thinking about. At the core of the skill, warding is the creation of magical equipment. How long will the wards that you draw on the ground last for? They said it would be long enough to not be annoying, however they want it to be balanced. With the addition of the farming guild and Privdinis, there will be 10 herb patches. Do you feel like this will be too many, and would you consider reducing PVM herb drops to balance this out? They said players shouldn't feel obliged to use them. The market will balance itself out eventually. Privdinis may not actually have a herb patch, it hasn't been pulled yet. With dwarfweed only used for ranging potions and runecrafting not having a boost, could be used with dark essence to make a +3 boost at level 90 herblore. They said it's not a bad idea to give dwarfweed more uses, however they wouldn't really like it for runecrafting. What happened to the idea of livestock farming? They said it's still an idea, however it will not be coming out with the farming guild expansion. If warding passes, would you remove imbues from current ring? They said yes, that'd be likely something we'd want to do, refunding the points of course. Of the items revealed at RuneFest 2018, what order are they going to be released into the game? First, the Kebos Lowlands, then the Song of the Elves, and then warding. Is the fish sack purely cosmetic? Yes, it's only cosmetic. What are the experience rates for warding? They said no idea, maybe 80k or more. It won't be super low, it will be likely in line with other artisan skills like fletching or crafting. Can we increase the max cape protection value? They said they would look into that. So this is less of a question, more of a statement. They said, we are aware that you want group Ironman mode. Mobile will come out, and for a few months after that, we'll be polishing that. And then after that, RS3 mobile is going to come out, and the engine team will be working on that. Group Ironman is on the cards and being looked at in its early stages. We didn't announce it at RuneFest, as we don't know when it could be looked into. It's behind about 9 months of other workload. Will the Hydra be a dragon for the Dragon Hunter crossbow? They said, yes, it will work, and also for the Slayer helm on task. Can the new anima patch seeds be untradeable? And they said yes they are. Are there plans for the warding skill to be integrated into quests or diaries? They said they're not looking to go backwards and change diaries or quests, however they could be used for future quests or diaries. With the huge increase in players with mobile, are you looking to make new worlds? They said yes, we do have a plan for more worlds when needed. Could the magic secateurs and farming cape yield bonus work for the updated cactus and bush patches? They said yes if the community wants it. What are the results of the discontinued item poll results? They said they're not going to change them in any way, and they'll still be spawned through the year and there won't be discontinued items. And that is it for the Q&A recap. And the last up here, I just wanted to have a look through some suggestions from Reddit this week. Starting off here with a suggestion by Pinuzo, and that is the warding skill should utilize some of the lesser used products of hunter or farming. So these are all very unused items from Hunter, and these are all very unused items from Farming. So giving them a use with the new warding skill would make sense, however I'm just not sure what these would make. Yes, it would be nice to give these items a use, because currently they're worthless and often just used to scam people on the Grand Exchange, honestly. However, I'm not really sure what these would make. You might still need the main ingredients, but maybe these could be like a secondary or something like that. Next up, a suggestion here by Primal Fears. This is another warding suggestion that's adding in even more content here. There are additional ring imbues, as well as of course the Archer Ring, Warrior Ring, and those will all be very high level imbues, as well as the Zenite item pieces, which would be level 98 warding to be maxed. That would make something to strive for, especially considering imbues are not tradable, so you wouldn't be able to just buy this. A suggestion by Invictus 2 is adding more hostile NPCs to some of the more frequently botted resources. Even something so simple as the Dark Wizards at the Willow Spot in Draenor, it causes a disturbance to bots. Obviously, you don't want to hinder real players too much, but an actual person will be able to deal with that extremely easily, whereas a bot might not be programmed to run away from these things. However, if they made that change, of course, they probably would be programmed to do that or go somewhere else, but that's not a reason not to change it. I personally think the only way that we'd actually ever deal with bots is by constantly changing things, just having a team dedicated to changing the game slightly to not impact real players, but to completely knock bots offline. I know when they update the client, sometimes it'll knock bots offline for like 2 days. So if you do that every 2 days, then maybe they'll be offline forever. I don't know, something to think of. So a legitimate reason why people are voting no on the warding skill is, where are we going to put the icon? Currently, we're kind of out of room. So unless we make the icons smaller, we are going to need to move the total level somewhere else. Now, Zambun Sen suggests we put it at the top here in kind of a longer row. I think it looks decent and I like the idea. However, maybe making it a little shorter, a little less black would make it nicer. But it's actually something to think about. And I think this is going to be a huge sticking point for warding if they can't find a place to put the damn skill counter. Anyway, guys, that is it for this week. What do you think of the updates in RuneFest? Tons of new information this week. Hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, don't forget to leave a like, and I'll see you next time.